Good afternoon. Thank you for your attendance today. We're going to give maybe a few seconds for folks to finish joining us. This is the Wire Transfer and Electronic Payment Fraud Seminar produced by Baker Donaldson. And so if by chance you are looking for the seminar on how to drive a boat through the Suez Canal, you've come to the wrong place. That seminar is another day and another time. This is a more exciting topic of wire transfer and electronic payment fraud. All right, that should be enough time. It's 1 minute after the hour. Again, good afternoon. I am Brad Trammell. I am resident in the Baker Donaldson office in Memphis, Tennessee. And today I am joined by John Green and Valerie Henderson. John is resident in our Atlanta, Georgia office, while Valerie is in our Houston, Texas office. John and I are in the financial services department, and Valerie is in our advocacy department. All three of us routinely handle financial services litigation, representing lenders and servicers and all sorts of crazy type of financial services disputes. Speaking of Atlanta and Memphis and Houston, and to make a shameless plug for our firm, you'll see a map of our offices stretching from Houston throughout the Southeast up to Washington and Baltimore, where we have a nice size office in Baltimore that's also doing financial services work. But if we can handle any of your needs all across the Southeast or tangent states such as Arkansas, we'd be happy to do so, along with your transaction works. Today, though, we're going to cover the topic of wire fraud and get into some cases and some details and end up talking maybe a little bit about payment via Venmo and PayPal. But before we begin, we got to go through a couple of housekeeping notes. And if you will notice that there is a Q&A box. So if you've got a question, type it in. No guarantees that we'll have time to get to it. But if we don't get to it during this webinar, then we will get to you, get back with you offline and be happy to address whatever you want addressed. We love your feedback after this seminar and helping us to maybe improve or maybe a few other things that you'd like to hear from us. So be sure to do that. We're also providing CLE credit. And in the states of Florida, Georgia, Louisiana, South Carolina, Tennessee, and Texas. But for those of you outside those states, I believe that we can help you get a CLE credit in your states as well, and we can provide materials and assistance with that. Just let us know how we can help you. I think that is there's one other housekeeping note, and that is throughout this webinar, we will have some polling questions. So trying to keep you on your toes, try to keep you awake. There'll be a couple times that we'll ask you to vote on certain questions that we have come up with, and I think you will enjoy that. So that'll be a little bit later on in the webinar. Why are we here today? And if you look at this first slide, you can see that there is a lot of money at stake. That's the bottom line. A lot of money is lost through internet crime and through problematic, if not fraudulent, wire transfers. And so we thought this would be a timely topic. You read about it in the paper. And so today we're going to delve in to it. The first part of this presentation will be given by John Green, and then Valerie Henderson will follow up. So, John, if you want to take it from here.
Thank you, Brad. Now, the first thing to know about this is what is the controlling provisions? And generally, the rules governing wires are UCC Article 4A. And as everyone knows, the UCC is a model set of laws that have been enacted generally in every state, although occasionally one state will have a minor change or two. So always bear that in mind, that some specific states might have some minor changes to the overall UCC. But for the purpose of this, I've tried to focus on what the UCC says. And the UCC 4A, it generally sets up all of the requirements for wires, and I've laid out kind of a number of transactions included in that. But in doing that, it also allocates the risk and responsibilities of the parties for when fraud or mistakes occur. And notably, those rules in the UCC Section 4A are different than elsewhere in the UCC. Elsewhere in the UCC, they tend to put the risk of loss on which party was in the best position to spot an error or fraudulent behavior. Here, every party has set duties, and if they change their duties and a loss occurs, the party that doesn't follow the letter of the rules is generally the one who's going to suffer the loss. Now, notably, UCC 4A does not cover transactions governed by the Electronic Funds Transfer Act, which is something my colleague Valerie will discuss towards the latter half of this webinar. Now, the wire frauds, usually majority of wire frauds go through in normal manner, no muss or fuss. Hundreds and of thousands of wire frauds or of wires go through every day, but they can go bad. One of the big reasons is fraudulent schemes, but they can also arise from other scenarios, such as rogue employees, or simply an error or miscommunication. As be noted later in the webinar, there are some stark reminders that if you hit the wrong button when typing in a wire, bad things can happen. But one of the most common types of wire fraud nowadays stem from business email compromise schemes. And this arises where a third party gets into someone's email, conducts a hack, learns that a wire's proceeding, and they will actually go in and try and alter the wire instructions. And here I've kind of laid out how a general fund transfer works, that you have the originator who provides wire instructions to the bank. It goes from one bank to the next till it hits the final bank, and then the money is supposed to be going into the beneficiary's account at the beneficiary's bank. But what happens is third parties will try and change the wire instructions. Sometimes it changes the account at the same bank. Other times they try and put a completely different bank with a completely different account in into the instructions.
All right, I told you there would be some polling questions. You probably didn't think there would be one this quick, but we're gonna start off with a question and let you choose an answer. Question is, an employee of Green Bank gets a phone call purporting to be from Elon Musk directing that it send a wire from his account. It turns out the request was fraudulent. The wire was sent and the funds were not recovered. Who bears the loss? And now you can vote for either Green Bank, Elon Musk, or it depends. Give you a moment to register your vote. I don't know who's voted, but can see, okay, we're getting on up into 20 or 30% of votes here. Who bears the loss? Green Bank, Elon Musk, or It Depends? All right, looks like we've got a good number that have responded. And the answer is, it's your polling answer, it was almost 60% of you thought Green Bank bears the loss. And It Depends comes in a close second somewhat at 40%. And the answer, It Depends. Yeah. John, what kind of answer is It Depends? That sounds like kind of a lawyer answer. Can't you just give us a straight yes or no?
Well, it was a trick question to begin with because it didn't outline the exact nature of the banking relationship between Elon Musk and Green Bank. The general rule is that originators are not obligated to pay an unauthorized wire transfer. Now, obviously, you run into a lot of situations where companies need to send a lot of wires. The CEO of the company or Elon Musk can't show up to the bank every day and show his ID to send the wires. So banks and the customers will have developed and will shift the loss by agreeing to certain security procedures. And as long as the originator's bank applies the security procedures and generally acts in good faith and the security procedures are deemed to be commercially reasonable, the Green Bank would not be liable. It would be on Elon Musk if for some whatever security procedures he chose were compromised. And there's a secondary exception to this that an originator, even if there are security procedures, may not be liable if he can prove that it was not directly caused by him or any agents or someone with access to their facilities or who gained information from Elon Musk. And obviously, it is very hard to prove a negative, but that kind of exception's out there. If you can prove that some super hacker just totally gamed the system without in some way compromising Elon Musk's personal security and information. But like I said, it's fairly hard to satisfy that exception. Now, the big question becomes, what is a commercially reasonable security procedure? And quite frankly, there is no answer. It is a flexible standard that depends on the size of the financial institution and the particular client involving the number of wires. And it's generally flexible because they want to allow a bank and its customer, based upon the needs and the available security measures, to go through and outline and come up with appropriate measures to allow the wires to go forward and allow business proceed, but without undue risk. Now, the cases are kind of all over the place as to what is a agreeable or a appropriate and reasonable security procedure, and it depends on a lot of factors. In the Patco construction case, the security procedures were found to be unreasonable because that particular bank opted to set a threshold for security questions at $1 that meant every wire had to have these answers or these questions answered, which exposed the answers to keyloggers and other things. And in addition, it was determined that although the bank employed risk scoring, it did not follow through on the risk scoring with additional security or other steps. And finally, it was noted that at this time, the bank in question was not using tokens, which had become fairly common for similar sized banks in the region. Similarly, dual control, which is where you have one employee set up the wire and another employee approve the wire, has been found to be commercially reasonable. And there is another exception that under UCC section 4A202C, that if a bank has a customer that does not want to follow through with all the security procedures, the bank and the customer can agree to lesser security procedures, albeit the customer has to agree to be bound by any payment orders in compliance with the lesser security procedure. And there's an additional avenue that I mentioned, which is good faith in applying the security procedures. In the Experimental Inc. v. Comerica Bank case, which came out a number of years in Michigan, the court looked at a situation where the security procedures were proper and every step was taken, a compromise had occurred that gave the bad actors the ability to send a number of unauthorized wires. But in this case, the court actually found that the bank, the originator's bank, did not act in good faith, and it was in looking at the gamut of the facts, and in this situation, there were over 97 wires sent in a few hours. They were all sent out of the country, and the originator in question was not in the custom or habit of sending a large amount of wires. They were not a 97 wires per couple of hours situation. And ultimately, the number of wires actually sent created an overdraft, which was something else that the client did not exhibit. And the general finding of the court was that the originator's bank, by not stepping in and, say, stopping it at wire number 10, had not exhibited good faith. And in this particular situation, the beneficiary bank, which was located overseas, actually reached out to the beneficiary's bank to raise the issue with all of these wires. And that's only when the beneficiary bank stepped in to stop everything. So in this case, the fact that the beneficiary's bank was asleep at the wheel resulted in the beneficiary bank being found to be liable because they just were not in good faith monitoring their duties.
All right. For those of you that have fallen asleep, it's time to wake up. We've got another polling question. Green Bank is at it again. This time it receives a wire intended for Elon Musk, but the account number listed belongs to Valerie Henderson. What should Green Bank do? First choice, deposit the money in the account for which the number was provided. Second choice, deposit the money in an account belonging to Elon Musk. For the third choice, reject the deposit. So if each of you would quickly vote, we'll see what the poll results are. Give you two or three more seconds. And let's see what the poll results are. Reject the deposits, overwhelming at 90 almost percent. And John, what is it? What's the answer?
Well, once again, it's because the question it doesn't provide the necessary detail. The answer could be pretty much any of these, but the pollsters are correct. The safest step is to reject the payment. Now, if Green Bank was unaware of discrepancy, it can deposit the funds based upon the account number alone, and UCC Section 4A actually encourages banks to not verify that the beneficiary name and the account match, because once again, the UCC 4A was designed to accommodate wires and keep it a very fast way to transfer money. So banks do not face additional risk if they simply handle the wires automatically and deposit the money into the stated account number. Now, a lot of people out there don't seem to understand that, and a lot of judges don't understand that. And if you get before them, you sometimes have to educate them at all stages of the litigation, because people don't seem to understand that it is imperative in the financial system to have fast wires to go out. Now, if Green Bank is aware of the discrepancy and deposits the money into Valerie's account, Green Bank would ultimately bear the risk of loss if there's a problem. And in there's an interesting case out of Florida that kind of examines this situation. It's the Corfon Banco v. Ocean Bank matter. And this case and its facts just kind of highlight that the good Samaritan who doesn't follow the exact words of the UCC does so at their own risk. In this case, the beneficiary's bank received a wire deposit of $72,000, and the bank noticed an error in the account number. There was no question that it went to the right beneficiary, but there was an error, so the beneficiary bank corrected the error, put it in the right account. I think they actually spoke with the beneficiary, who said, yes, that was supposed to go in this account. But the originating bank realized that it made a mistake and sent a second wire after it originally sent the first wire with the incorrect account number, and the second wire had the correct account number. So a total of $144,000 was sent to the beneficiary instead of $72,000. The beneficiary withdrew all the money and refused to return the money, and the originating bank sued the beneficiary bank for improperly accepting the wire. So ultimately, the beneficiary bank had to pay the $72,000 back because it was found to have breached the duty of care by changing the account number and accepting the funds. Now, going back to the example, if your Green Bank and Elon Musk is telling you to go ahead and deposit the money, there was just a slight account number. Well, you know, sometimes you have to do things for your best customers, but the best practice is to either allow it to go through if you have no idea of the misdescription, or to reject it. Now, similarly, nowadays in the modern world, banks can't always go through and let wires go through without any human touch. And a fairly recent case out of the 11th Circuit is very instructive on this. And in this case, the Shapiro matter, there were the beneficiary bank received the wire, and there was it had no knowledge of a misdescription of the beneficiary. And ultimately, a lawsuit occurred because the transaction was fraudulent. And during the course of discovery, it came out that because of the nature of the wire and who the recipient was, that the wire was manually reviewed by for compliance with the Office of Foreign Assets Control. And at the end of the day, it was found that even though someone had manually reviewed this wire, this person was not looking at it for the purpose of whether or not the account and the beneficiary matched, but simply whether it violated foreign asset control. And because this person was looking at it for a totally separate reason, it was found not to have knowledge when it accepted the wire. And the second stage is the review occurred after the wire had been accepted by automatic means. Now, there's always a related issue that comes up, and that's preemption. Under Section 4A, it is intended to be the exclusive means of determining the rights, duties, and liabilities of affected parties in any situation, which means that there is some limited preemption. And generally, the way the courts interpret it is that courts will not counter the rules when it deals with the four corners of Section 4A. But if there is something outside of the four corners, some duty, they will find that there is no preemption. Now, I know that's fairly difficult to understand, and the best way is kind of look at situations where preemption has been found. And in one notable case, the Regions Bank case, it allowed a lawsuit and a state law claim to survive that alleged that the beneficiary bank had knowledge that a fraud was going on, and it found that there was no preemption under the state law claim to disgorge the funds. And generally, that seems to be a situation at kind of in the consortio industrial matter as well. A state law claim was also allowed for failing to return funds that it knew were sent in error. And then in the Narov ingredients case, a negligence claim was allowed not relating to the acceptance of the wire, but the beneficiary's bank allowing a hacker to actually open a checking account. And in the 3T Oil and Gas Services case, the beneficiary bank, a negligence claim was allowed against the beneficiary bank because there had been a misrepresentation or an alleged misrepresentation that the wire was being stopped and the funds were being held pending an investigation. But in fact, the money was withdrawn. So what to expect when it comes to some of these cases. The first rule of wire fraud cases is when a significant loss occurs, the party bearing the loss, usually either the originator or the beneficiary, will sue everyone, just because when the numbers are that big, they will sue in the hopes of getting enough money from various parties to make themselves whole or at least minimize the loss. And another issue with these cases, which all financial institutions need to be aware of is these cases can be discovery intensive, and they also can delve into some sensitive issues. Just in some of the example cases, one allowed discovery into OFAC compliance. In another case, you noted a couple of the non-preempted issues were, you know, whether or not a bank erred in allowing a fraudulent account to be opened. So a lot of banks get very hesitant to let discovery go on into some of those areas. That's always a consideration in handling and defending situations related to wire fraud, is if enough money is at stake, it can require a significant amount of discovery. You know, there's another thing that a lot of parties outside the financial services industry don't understand, that once money hits an account controlled by a fraudster, that money usually disappears. Usually the money will come in, and they'll find various ways to wire it to other accounts, usually in a smaller number. But if people don't check up their wires and act quickly, the money can disappear. You know, something that financial institutions should always think about is if you've accepted money and you get a recall order or something else, think about freezing the money. And potentially, if they consider an interpleader, because it's always best if there's a question as to whose money it goes to, file an interpleader. That way, you can't get various conversion claims out there. And hold harmless agreements are, you know, generally required by most banks in recalling wires. And always remember, UCC Section 4A does provide liability for late and improper execution of wires. Now, I know I'm out of time, but one last thing is, if you are dealing with a wire issue involving one of your customers that has a wire agreement that, such as I discussed earlier, where you have the security procedures and everything else, cases have been found that indemnification provisions are not preempted if all the requirements and security procedures were met. So it's always good to review those agreements and see if there is any indemnification or attorney's fees provisions that may provide some recourse if you have one of your clients adding you to a suit. I'm gonna turn this over to my wonderful colleague, Valerie Henderson, who will step into the second part of the webinar dealing with the Electronic Funds Transfer Act.
Thanks, John. So I'll start my part of this to talk about a case that you may have heard about. It involved a recent wire transfer gone wrong involving Citibank. Specifically, Citibank, acting in its capacity as administrative agent for a syndicated term loan taken out by Revlon, intended to wire approximately $7.8 million in interest payments to Revlon's lenders. And instead, Citibank mistakenly wired almost $900 million of its own money. The resulting payments equaled the amounts of principal interest that Revlon owed on the loan to its lenders. Citibank quickly filed suit in New York against the recipients to attempt to recover the erroneously wired funds. While in general, the law treats a failure to return money that's wired by mistake as unjust enrichment or conversion and requires that the recipient return the money to its sender, New York law is unique and has an exception to this general rule that applies throughout most of the rest of the country. Under New York law, the recipient is allowed to keep the funds if they discharge a valid debt. The recipient made no misrepresentations to induce the payment, and the recipient did not have notice of the mistake. This is called the discharge for value defense, and it ended up being the key issue in the Citibank case. On the discharge for value defense, the court in Citibank determined that this defense applied. The defense provides that when a beneficiary receives money to which it's entitled and has no knowledge that the money was erroneously wired, the beneficiary should not have to wonder whether it may retain the funds. Rather, such a beneficiary should be able to consider the transfer of funds as a final and complete transaction, not subject to revocation. So as I said before, this is very unique to New York law, but it ended up having significant ramifications on the outcome in the Citibank case, because the court determined that this defense applied, and so Citibank was not entitled to its money back. The defendants who received the erroneous wire kept the funds. So there are certainly lessons to be learned from the Citibank case. First is that New York law is sometimes unique, and that certainly had a significant effect. Also, as a result of the outcome in this case, many banks are now adding clauses in the form of accidental payment covenants in debt documents. These covenants allow the bank to demand repayment of any money sent to third parties by mistake. The covenant typically will give the banks the sole power to determine whether a payment was made by mistake and to demand its repayment based on certain procedures.
Hey, Valerie, let me jump in here on that Citibank issue, because I thought I read an article or saw something somewhere about the recipients of this money. I think there were some hedge funds, and there's been some, maybe they were blackballed or something happened. Are you familiar with that? Have you heard anything about that? Other lessons that our financial services clients might be able to use?
Yes, I have read that is what is occurring, and it's certainly a lesson to be learned from this, that if an entity thinks they've received a wire in by mistake, then to definitely look into that, but also that long-term business relationships can be more important sometimes than a single transaction, obviously. And so that's something to consider when determining what to do with funds that you ultimately learn have been received by mistake, and determining how to apply them and what to do with them. Next, we'll talk about the voluntary payment doctrine, which can also come into play in the context of wire transfers. Under the common law voluntary payment doctrine, a party cannot sue to recover payments made knowingly and voluntarily, absent fraud or duress. Under the doctrine, the onus is on a party that receives what it perceives as an improper demand for money to take its position at the time of the demand and litigate the issue before rather than after the payment is made. So to protest the payment and overcome the voluntary payment doctrine, the aggrieved party must do so in writing and at the time of payment. The written protest must also indicate that the plaintiff is reserving their right when the payment is made and must communicate as much to the party receiving the payment. So, for example, the court in Walton versus New York State Department of Correctional Services in New York held that the protest requirement would have been fulfilled by a letter to the recipient of the payment and the entity levying the charge at the time the bills were paid. The intention of the voluntary payment doctrine is to require an engaged consumer and ultimately to prevent litigation for over situations that should have and could have been addressed prior to litigation and outside of the courtroom. For example, in Spivey versus Adaptive Marketing, the Seventh Circuit held that the voluntary payment doctrine precluded the consumer from recovering $500 in annual credit card payments to a telemarketing company that was paid over a span of 5 years when the consumer did not realize he had agreed to the charge but had made no effort to discover the nature of it and had just paid it in silence without protest. Similarly, in Dillon versus UA Columbia Cablevision, a New York court held that the voluntary payment doctrine barred a customer's right to recover late fees paid to a cable television company, even though such fees were allegedly unlawful penalties that were mischaracterized. In the wire transfer context, banks are allowed to use funds wired into accounts as set off. An example of this issue arising is set forth in Community Bank versus Stevens Financial Corporation, which was a case out of Indiana, where the beneficiary bank who had received an erroneously transmitted wire transfer was found to be entitled to set off for a pre-existing debt of the beneficiary, despite the efforts to cancel the payment order. So in that case, Homeside and Stevens Financial were parties to a loan purchase agreement where Homeside would purchase mortgages from Stevens. As part of that agreement, Homeside agreed to purchase a mortgage on a residential property in California. Homeside was originally supposed to wire the funds for the purchase to Community Bank, but received amended instructions instructing them to wire the funds to Chase Bank. However, Homeside ultimately wired the funds to Community Bank, the first bank it had been told to wire the funds to. Community Bank received the wire transfer and then credited a large portion of those funds to satisfy an outstanding debt of Stevens Financial to Community Bank. Once Homeside realized their mistake, they notified Community Bank of the error and asked Community Bank to cancel the transfer and return the funds. However, Community Bank refused to return the funds because it had already set off the amount of Stevens Financial's obligation on the debt owed to Community Bank. So Homeside sued, seeking to recover the total amount that had been wired to Community Bank. But the court held that at the time of the transfer, there was no way for Community Bank to know that the payment order was sent in error or that Homeside was instructed to send the payment to a different lender. So the court held that since Community Bank properly followed the funds without or applied the funds without knowledge of any mistake, then it was free and clear to collect that amount and apply it as a set off.
And time for another polling question. This time, it's Green Credit Card Company, who I assume is just a subsidiary of Green Bank. But in any event, it mistakenly charges Elon Musk a late fee, and he pays it. Musk realizes it was placed on his account by mistake and sues Green Bank. Can he recover the funds? And this is an easier question because you've got a 50-50 shot, whereas the other ones, yeah, you've got a 1 out of 3. Now you got a 1 out of 2 shot. Answer yes or no. So please vote quickly. 50-50 shot, yes or no. Can he recover the funds? And I'll give you a couple more seconds. All right, let's see what the results of the poll show. Oh, sorry about that. 73% say yes, about 27% say no. Valerie, tell us about the answer.
So the answer is probably not another attorney answer, neither yes nor no. And it really depends on the jurisdiction, of course, as always, since some of the rules are different in depending on the jurisdiction. But In most jurisdictions, green credit card company could assert the voluntary payment doctrine as a defense to Elon Musk's attempt to recover the money he paid. And so under that doctrine, the onus is on Elon Musk to have challenged the erroneous charge at the outset prior to paying it. So absent fraud by a green credit card company or duress, the voluntary payment doctrine would likely apply. So next, we will turn to the Electronic Fund Transfer Act, also known as the EFTA. This act has been around since 1978. It establishes the rights, liabilities, and responsibilities of participants in electronic fund transfer systems. The act requires financial institutions to adopt certain practices regarding transaction accounting and error resolution. It also requires financial institutions and others to have certain procedures for pre-authorized transfers and sets liability limits for losses caused by unauthorized transfers. The act has been substantially amended over the years by the Credit Card Act and the Dodd-Frank Act. The EFTA requires financial institutions involved in electronic fund transfers to disclose certain information to consumers before the transaction at issue. It also provides consumers with protections related to unauthorized transactions. An unauthorized electronic fund transfer under the EFTA is an electronic transfer from a consumer's account initiated by a person other than the consumer without authority to initiate the transfer and from which the consumer receives no benefit. Under the Act, this does not include an electronic funds transfer initiated either by a person who was furnished an access device to the consumer's account by the consumer with fraudulent intent by the consumer or any person acting in concert with the consumer or by the financial institution or its employee. So peer-to-peer payment platforms such as Venmo, Zelle, and PayPal are continuously gaining in popularity. These platforms are also subject to the EFTA, and banks allowing electronic transfers through these platforms must provide required disclosures to consumers, as well as comply with procedures for consumer notifications, investigation of unauthorized transfers, and resolution of alleged fraudulent or unauthorized transfers within specific timeframes. Recently, a class action was filed in October of 2020 on behalf of some of Cash App customers nationwide who had reported fraudulent charges on this app. The lawsuit named Square Inc., the creator of Cash App, as a defendant, and it named Sutton Bank because this bank partners with Square to provide this app to users with a Cash App bank card known as a cash card. The lawsuit was brought under the EFTA and New York law. The plaintiffs alleged that they were the victims of electronic fraud when unknown perpetrators fraudulently misrepresented themselves in efforts to obtain the payment information in this Cash App platform. The plaintiffs alleged that Square Inc. and Sutton Bank's error resolution procedures violated the EFTA dispute process provisions in a number of ways. This case is in the early stages, but it will be one to watch to see how the EFTA is applied to the Cash App system. And it'll be interesting to see the ramifications of this case and how it applies in this new developing area of the law related to wire transfer fraud. So with all this information that we've thrown at y'all today, you may be wondering what to do to prevent wire transfer fraud. Most wire fraud incidents are preventable through implementation of specific policies developed with the assistance of counsel. Conducting employee training and implementing technical IT measures. It's important to require employees to verify wire information and bank account information by calling a known telephone number to confirm that what they may have received via email is correct and that they're talking to the person that actually authorized the transaction. It's also important to require extra scrutiny of international wires and real estate transactions because these two types of transactions have been the focus of a lot of fraudsters, it appears, based on the types of cases that we've seen. And so it's important to require extra scrutiny of the transactions that involve international wires and real estate. It's also important to provide training for employees who handle or deal with wire transfers regularly so that they can be on the lookout for any type of fraud. Ensure that you have written agreements with all customers prior to wiring funds so that the customer knows the parameters of the wire transfer and they can also be made aware of potential fraud. Also enable multi-factor authentication for internet-based email and account access and enable technical alerts through your IT department to alert for suspicious logins and email accounts from internet providers possibly that are outside of the United States. This also seems to be a source of potential wire transfer fraud is from varying email addresses that purport to be the person providing the instructions but are actually the fraudster. Also, it's important to educate customers and business partners by including a wire fraud warning in emails. Oftentimes, the lending institution or the mortgage servicer or whomever the bank entity might be is very familiar with the possibility of wire fraud, but the customer may not be. So it's important to educate them from the outset of the possibility for wire fraud so that they're on the lookout for anything suspicious related to a possible wire transfer. It's also important to work with your legal counsel to develop an incident response plan so that employees know what to do if a wire fraud incident occurs. If you suspect an incident has occurred, act quickly once your organization discovers the fraud and gather as much information as possible. It's important to determine when the fraud occurred, who authorized the transaction, determine the value of the transaction, and identify the account at issue and the individuals or entity associated with the account. You should attempt to recall the lost funds from the corresponding financial institution if possible. However, it is often the case that as soon as the funds hit the account of the fraudster, they are often gone quickly. So it's another reason to act quickly if you suspect wire fraud. Contact your insurance carrier. A lot of insurance policies have specific coverage for funds transfer fraud or similar cybersecurity incidents, so it's important to contact your insurance carrier to determine what coverage you have. And lastly, contact the appropriate authorities to report the fraud. That's all I have today, so I'll turn it back over to Brad. Thank you.
And we did have one follow-up question on the Corfon case, and the question was, where was the beneficiary who took out the $144,000 instead of $72,000 in that situation? And unfortunately for the beneficiary bank, the beneficiary, when they withdrew the money, they promised to return it, but no money ever came forward. But if you were in a situation where your ultimate beneficiary had funds, the beneficiary bank would have had several options to theoretically pull the money and reclaim it. One would be unjust enrichment, money hadn't received, and often the terms of use or customer agreements when it comes to bank accounts will allow money to, you will provide some contractual rights to get the money back as well. In addition, if there was a situation where there was fraud or a misrepresentation, you'd have a potential claim for fraud or negligent misrepresentation. So there generally are some options for beneficiary banks to try and get the money back, but it's that pesky reality that the majority of the time when something happens, Elon Musk isn't on the other end of the transaction who can stroke a check to repay it. There are bad people out there.
John, thanks. We're on the Q&A slide, but I must admit, and John picked up a quick question. There are so many questions that we could never get to them between now and even 2:30 Central. So what we're going to do, we're not going to ignore them. John or Valerie or I or somebody from our financial services team, which is pretty deep with folks, will get back and answer each of these questions. If not today, then tomorrow. I'm just sorry. I didn't expect to have this many questions, but we've got a lot. We will get to them just as quickly as we can. But before we leave, two other points. One about CLE credit. Again, if you're in those listed states, it's already been submitted for approval. But if you're not there, let's say that you're in Missouri or some other state that's not listed there, then we can work with you to help you get CLE credit. But regardless, we appreciate your time. We're so glad that you could be with us today. And we will have another one of these in this series. We started this in the pandemic maybe April or May of last year and have been producing these basically once a month and for our financial services clients out there, and it seems to be a hit. So we're going to continue to do this. At the end of April, April the 28th, we'll have another CLE webinar on FACTA, on the Fair and Accurate Credit Transactions Act. And I know you're thinking that seems pretty narrow, but we're seeing some issues with that particular, with litigation and decisions in that realm that I think have bigger results than just FACTA. And those are turning on standing in the issue of whether or not a litigant has standing to bring such a claim simply because they've not been injured. And we've seen that recently, if y'all are keeping up with it, some recent cases out of the Seventh Circuit involving FDCPA claims have been turned back because of the lack of standing by individuals. So you'll want to sign up for that. Be on the lookout for that email here in a couple of weeks on FACTA, which will again occur on April the 28th. We thank you again for participating today, and we will get back with your questions. But until then, thanks and look forward to seeing you next month.